Okay, good morning, students. So we'll continue with briefing out in the last sessions what we have done, last lectures what we have done. Then we continue with the today's lecture. So in the last few classes, we were seeing about the multi-processing UST and KLT, ULT and KLT. And we have seen about what is KLT. KLT is a kernel level thread. So where you can create threads in both the sites, either by the user or by the kernel. So that's what we have just seen in this picture. And so here you can see in the first A image, multi-threads are created in a user space, means by a thread library. We are using thread user is using a thread library and creating a multi-threads. That is what is being done in a A diagram. And in part B, so multi-threads are created in both the sites. One is in the operating system as well as one in the user space. And one more we have seen about combined. So in the third diagram, what did we see is both the spaces, either in the kernel or in the user space, both the ways we can create a threads either in the kernel space and the user space. So we have seen this in the last few lectures, and we have seen what is KLT is doing. So KLT is where we are just creating multi-threads in a kernel site. That's what part B, diagram B shows to us. So both in kernel and in the we are creating in a kernel, and the same is being used by the user. And in the third part B, we have seen that it is being done in a both the places, one in kernel and one in user space. And we have seen some advantages of KLT. So KLT has three advantages. Simultaneously scheduling will take can be done by a multi-threads. Simultaneously means concurrently, same time, the same process on the same thing. And we have seen about two more advantages. One thread in the process is blocked. The kernel can schedule another thread of the same process. And we have seen kernel routine themselves can be multi-threaded. And we have seen combined approach. That's what I told. Combined approach means combining both the things, the ULT as well as KLT. ULT is where we are creating multi-threads in a user level threads, as well as KLT is what? Kernel level thread. So where we are doing it in a kernel, multi-threads are created in, we can create in both the places, one in ULT or one in KLT. That's what we the combined approach says to us. And we have seen the relationship between how the thread and the process have the relationship. We have seen thread one to one, one thread, one process, or many threads, one process, a relationship between threads and the process. And one thread, many process, or many to many. So, and we have seen what is SMP is. So, symmetric multiprocessing, symmetric systematic way of using a multiprocessing. And before moving on to SMP, we have just seen about what is the SMP architecture says to us. In SMP architecture, that's what the parallel processing. Parallel processing means the same work is being done by a multiple process at the same time. So parallel process again divided into SIMD and MIMD. What is SIMD? Single instruction, multiple data stream. And what is MID? MID is multiple instruction, multiple data stream. And again in MIMD, it is further divided into shared memory and distributed memory. What is shared memory? So the memory is being shared between multiple people. Distributed memory, where the operating system is loosely coupled, where distributed means the operating system is placed in two or three systems. And again, in distributed system, we have clusters. We'll see what is clusters later in our further classes. Then shared memory, we have a client server, or we here in this term, they call it as a master slave. And one more is symmetric multiprocessor. So master slave, again, there is a disadvantage. So we are symmetric multiprocessor is used. So SSID, SIMD, MIST, MIMD, we have seen this. And we have seen the disadvantages of master-slave, that is client-server architecture. So failure of master brings down the whole system. Suppose if one system where you are calling that as a master, and if that master by mistake or something happened to that master and it is not working, then complete whole thing will be down. So that is a disadvantage of having a master-slave architecture. And one more problem with the master-slave is, the master has to do all scheduling and process management. So the master has to say who has to do what, everything. So then the performance may slow down because everything has been put on only one machine. That's the reason it will come down. So the same thing, you can take real-time example. If in family, if there are five people and there is only one person earning, other four are just sitting and not doing any work, then it becomes a burden to only one person. Same way here also, if that person by chance or something accidentally is no more, then how about the four other people? So that becomes very difficult. Same way here also, if something goes wrong to the master, then this whole system will be failed. That is one disadvantage. And one more, everything, scheduling, process management will be done by only one machine. If that goes wrong something, then it will be difficult in performance also. The performance is also comes down. So then we have seen about SMP organization, how the SMP is being organized. We have seen that main memory is only one thing, and where the other things like processor and input-output can be scheduled parallelly. So that's what you can see in this diagram. We have different processors. You may have a number of processors, but we have only one main memory. And we have a different input-output adapters or input-output things where we can use. So examples, you can say keyboard is, we may use keyboard also, we may use mouse also, we may use other devices. So that's what we may use it. So we have an option in our this thing to use. So then processors, so initially before some years down the line, there was only one processor. And it was taking so much time for owning everything. So to come out with that disadvantage, so they are using a multiprocessor. You would have seen even nowadays we have a dual processor, multiprocessor means dual means more. Two processors, two operating systems you can use. So that's what here in this diagram you can see there are different processors. And we have a cache memory, one in a processor as well as one in the system bus. Why we need cache memory? I told you even in the last classes also. There is a speed mismatch between a main memory and the processor. To make up this speed, we are using a cache memory. So this single system bus has to handle so many things. And suppose this is asking something and it has to wait. So all those things can be placed in a cache memories L1 and L2. So you may have a different processors here and only one main memory which is being shared by all these people. All the processors as well as all the input-output. This we have seen in the last class. And again, multiprocessor OS design consideration, we have seen that there were so many other properties where simultaneous concurrent process or threads, scheduling, synchronization, memory management, reliability and fault tolerance. We have seen all these in the last classes. And again, we have seen about a microkernel. So what is microkernel? Micro means what? Means what? Small. Kernel means operating, small operating systems. When do we require this small operating system? When I have a specific application where I want only for that operation, only that particular thing to work. In that case, we use a microkernel. So even last class also I gave you an example. Microkernel can be used in many, many real-time examples where let us take a washing machine or your micro oven. Like this, we have so many real-time examples where microkernels are used. So microkernel, small operating system. So we'll take an example with the washing machine. What the washing machine will be doing, if we have to just press a on button, automatically it will start, it will take water, it will rinse, it will dry. So only these options, properties is required for a washing machine. So only that related things will be pushed in the washing machine operating system. So we have a manual also, you can set that or automatically. That is left to the operating system, which one you have used. So in the same way, micro oven also, we can shift, change the heat, temperature, what is the time required for you to make your dish, or either you can heat the food. So that's how those are a small operating system where used only for that purpose. So that is the place where we are using the microkernel. It's a small one. So microkernel architecture, and we have seen what was the advantage and what was the disadvantage. Why do we require microkernel? And before, there was no process of having a exact architecture. But because of this, we require an architecture. We have seen this also. What was the disadvantage of having a layered architecture, and what is the use of microkernel? And we have seen that. So this is what we have seen, layered kernel, where it is one above the other. In a microkernel, you can see the layers are in a vertical, whereas in a layered approach, there is in a horizontal. One above the other. Whereas in a microkernel, you can see they are placed in the vertical layers. Along, not only that, you can even see in this diagram, the main functions are in a kernel, in a layered approach, layered kernel. All the working are also present in a kernel, as well as in a user. Whereas in a microkernel, we can see that the only the basic components, what is required, is placed in the microkernel, and rest of them are given to the user mode. That those are the main things which is required in a kernel architecture. And we have seen, but the layered approach had problems. Change in one layer could affect the working of adjacent layer. And we have seen that if you want to shift, suppose let us take the basic, you have started with a small operating system of a microkernel, and you have done with the basic model of micro oven, and you want to enhance that. Then to enhance that, you need to add some more modules to the existing basic module. In that, when you are enhancing, if you are considering a layered approach, then it will become a problem, because there were layered changes in one layer may affect for the other. Whereas in a microkernel, that is not there. So that's what. To solve such problem, the concept of microkernel has been proposed. Here, only essential core OS functions will be in a kernel. That's what. Only essential part, which are main thing, only that will be present in a microkernel. And other functions will be given to the user. The benefits of having a microkernel is, it is uniform interface, extensibility, flexibility, portability, reliability, and distributed system support. The support for object-oriented system. These are the advantages of having a microkernel. And how do we increase the performance of the microkernel? There are certain disadvantage of microkernel with respect to their performance, because it is very small. It takes longer to build and send a message. So everything, whatever we do it through the messaging. Messaging only we are doing in a microkernel. A longer time to accept and decode the reply. Performance depends on size and the functionality of the microkernel. So this is what the microkernel performance with respect to microkernel, because micro means small. And how do they've designed a microkernel design? There is no set rules to indicate what function must be provided in a microkernel and what structure has to be implemented. But in general, it should follow the same rules what it is there. And lower level memory management, the microkernel has to control the hardware concept of the address space to make it possible to implement the protection of the process level. Also, it should map each virtual page of a physical. So that's what we have seen this. It is also mapping. So the application where software project is, and that should be passed, and the address space. Pager is something like where we are keeping all our data in a memory. So in microkernel, the memory space will be very small. very small memory space, and this with the respect to software and the memory, the operating system should take care in case if anything, any faults or something is happening. So this page faults also may occur in the microkernel. And we have seen inter-process communication between two processes is also in inter-process communication. And we've seen input-output and interrupt management. And next we move on to a CPU scheduler. So this is very important part. At least one scheduler definitely you may expect in your exam. So CPU scheduling is a basic of a multi-programmed operating system. By switching CPU among process, the OS takes more computer more productive. So what is CPU scheduler means? We should see to that the processor should not be idle and it should be used maximum time. We should not make the processor. CPU means what? Processor. So processor should not be idle. In multi-programming operating system, some processor has to keep running all the time in CPU without keeping it idle. So that's what here, what the CPU in CPU scheduler will be doing is, it should, the algorithms, all the CPU, there are so many algorithms, we'll see one by one. But what the main concept in CPU scheduler is, we should see to that, the CPU should not be idle. A maximum utilization of CPU should be done. And we have, whenever the CPU becomes idle, the OS must select one process in ready queue to be executed. Once one process executed, other process should be taken by the operating system. Now the selection process is carried out by a short-term scheduler. That's what, which one should we take? That will be decided by the algorithm which is present in your processor. The process picks generally, if it is general one, what the processor will do in the ready queue is first come, who comes in the first queue, only that will be processed first. That's what shortest job. There are so many various algorithms like shortest job, round robin, etc. We'll see them one by one. And we have seen a CPU and input output burst cycle. The success of CPU scheduling depends upon the following properties. So when do we say the CPU scheduling algorithm is very good? So based on some criteria, some properties only, we can say the CPU has been maximum utilized. The process execution consists of cycle of CPU execution and input-output wait. The process alternate between these two states as process execution begins with the CPU burst. That is followed by an input-output burst. So how do this CPU burst is, once the process is there, and the process and the input-output. CPU, input-output. Like this, one after the other, it keeps going on. So that's what you can see. CPU burst, input-output. CPU burst, input-output. CPU burst, input-output. So this is the histogram and the alternate sequence. So one after the other. Sequence means once CPU has been utilized, if that processor is asking for the input output, it will go when it is taking input output, then processor. So like this, switching, alternating the sequence of CPU and input output burst keeps on going. Then the pre-emptive scheduling. Pre means what? Before. Scheduling the CPU before we have any algorithm, scheduling algorithm. So there is a pre-emptive and non-pre-emptive. Pre-emptive means before that particular time only they have come out. That is pre-emptive. So what are the reasons to come out before time? Yes, there are four reasons. So the process switches from running state to waiting state. That is first option where the process will come out before the time completes. And the second one, process switches from a running state to ready state. So the second option is running state, either the process may be moving from a running state to ready state, or it may be waiting a state to a ready state, or the last one is terminate. And we have seen out of these four, two are pre-emptive and two are non-pre-emptive. Non-pre-emptive means, so that's what you can see in this situation, one and four above, there is no choice for scheduling a new process to be taken from a ready queue. This is called as a non-pre-emptive scheduling. So in this first one, what it is doing, it is moving from a running state to waiting state. So because waiting state, when do the process go for waiting state? It's maybe it may require some value from a keyboard. So in that case, it has to wait because the keyboard has to give some value. So then this is called as a non-preemptive. It is not coming out, but it is going for a waiting state because it is requesting for a input values. Or the fourth one, the process is complete. So then it gets terminated. That's what a non-preemptive schedulings will be done. And in the situations 2 and 3, there is preemptive. Preemptive means before that time, it will come out. So you can see running to ready state. It's still running, but the time is completed and the process is not completed. So then again, it should go back to the ready queue. That is one preemptive. Because time is over, the time fixed. So take an example here, 1 hour is given to each staff. So if you take after 1 hour, you'll not be allowed. So you have to, suppose my algorithm is not completed in 1 hour, I cannot continue that. I have to break at 1 hour. The same algorithm will be continued in the next day of my class. So that's what here the running second process has been done. So we have seen this non-preemptive and preemptive. So the dispatcher means how to switch from one to another. And scheduling criteria, what are the different criteria used for scheduling? Different scheduling algorithm have a different properties. The one will be having each own property. Suppose different types of process. There are many criteria to compare CPU scheduling algorithm as given. The CPU utilization, how much you are utilizing your process, how much you are utilizing the CPU. That's what CPU is related. Throughput, the number of process completed per time. That is what is called as a throughput. Turnaround time, when started, when end. That is turnaround time. How much time I have to wait for my time to execute. That is waiting time. Response time, how much time the processor has taken to get back the values from the keyboard. That's what the response time. So when do we say the CPU is maximum utilized or optimized is when we are using a CPU maximum, when there is a throughput maximum, and turnaround time is minimum, waiting time is minimum, and response time is minimum, then we'll say that it is a good CPU scheduling algorithm. So then a scheduling algorithm, so very important. Definitely one will be there out of these, one problem or one concept. So CPU scheduling deals with the problem of deciding which of the process is ready queue to be allocated by the CPU. So first one is first come first serve scheduling. So first come first serve. So suppose you go for a temple, take a real time example, you have a queue, ordinary queue. So we may have different queues. Right now we will not worry, we have only one queue. All the ordinary people go to a temple in a one queue. Who enters the queue first will be the person to come out first. So that's what the in temples goes on. That is what first come first serve. So the same concept is used here. First, who comes to the queue first, that will be that person will be coming out first. So taking an example, there are three processes. So you consider here P1, P2, P3. Arriving at a time zero, all three processors 1, 2, 3 arrives a ready queue. They are ready, and the first who enters the ready queue is P1. P1, how much time it requires to complete its job is 24 milliseconds, and P2, how much time it will take to complete its job is 3 milliseconds, and for P3, it will take 3 milliseconds. So that's what you can see. But what is the, they would have given in your exam the exam something like this. Example one, there are three process and they'll give you this diagram and you have to start writing the ground solution. You have to calculate the average waiting time and the average turnaround time. They'll be asking and they'll be giving you how much process are there, how much time they have taken. So you have to draw a Gantt chart something like this. So P1, how much time it starts from zero, how much time it has taken? It has taken 24 milliseconds. After P1 is completed, only P2 will go because it is a first come first serve. So who is first now? P1 is first. So P1 will complete, till P1 completes, P2 and P3 has to wait. So how much time they have to wait? how much time P1 will take to complete. So P1 will take to complete is 24 milliseconds. Now the after 24 only P2 will go. So P2 will, how much time is required for P2? 3 milliseconds. So 24 plus 3 is what? 27. So after 27 only P3 will be able to take the CPU utilization. So this is what a Gantt chart. You have to draw something like this. So at least I hope so it will be clear for you. 0 to 24 is what? The time taken for the processor P1. After 24 only, add 24 plus 3. P2 is how much time it is taking? 3. 24 plus 3 is what? 27. So by 27 milliseconds means P1 and P2 completed their job. After 27 only, P3 can get a CPU for execution. So how much time P3 requires? P3 requires 3 milliseconds. 27 plus 3 is what? 30. So this is what the diagram depicts you with the example. So and here we have to write a waiting time. That's what they have told, right? So calculate average waiting time. So first we say for P1, what is a waiting time? 0. What is a waiting time for P2? It has to 24. Wait till P1 completes. So how much time P1 is taking? 24. So 24 milliseconds is a time taken for P2 to wait. So now P2 waiting time is 24. The same way, P3 waiting time is what? P3 waiting time is P1 plus P2 has to complete their job. Then only P3 will get a time. So P1 plus P2 time. So P1 will take 24 plus P2 will take 3. 24 plus 3 is what? 27. So 27 milliseconds P3 has to wait. So now calculate the average 0 plus 24 plus 27. How much is the time taken? Calculate that divided by 3 is an average waiting time. So that's what here you can see. The waiting time for P1 is 0. The waiting time for P2 is 24. Waiting time for P3 is equal to 27. So add all those 3 divided by 3. Divided by 3, why? Why 3? Because here in our example, they have given 3 processor. May not be the same for all the examples. They may vary the processor here because in this example, they have given only P3, 3 processor. It may increase or it may decrease left how the processors are being given. So that's why 3. I think 3 is clear. And this 0, 24 and 27 should be clear because 0 is a time taken for P1. It is not waiting. Because CPU was free, so it will enter for the CPU. That's what 0. So why P2 24? Because P1 is taking 24. It has to wait till the 24. So that's what P2 is. P3 is what? Again, 27. Why 27? P1 and P2 has to complete. Then only 27. So then turnaround time. The time taken to complete the process. P1 how much it is taking? 24. P2 how much? P1 after P1 completes only P2 will take. So 27. So then P3 is what? P3 will take. How much time P3 is taking? P3 is taking 30. So calculate that and divide it by number of processes is 27. So this is an example. Let us take move forward. Throughput is what? The total number of processes completed per unit time. So for one particular time, how much we have taken? So in our example, 30 time units were completed. How many processes? 3. So 3 divided by 30 is what? 0.1. So that is what the throughput for this example. So let us take one more example and stop here because the left time is only 8 minutes. So assuming in the above example, the process arrives the order P2, P3, P1 order. So now the order is being changed. So then the Gantt chart. So in the earlier example, what was the order? P1, P2, P3. Now the order is changed P2, P3, P1. So now how much can we not calculate the waiting time and the turnaround time? We can. So here waiting time for P1 is what? How much time? P1 has to wait. P2 is taking how much time? 3 milliseconds. P3, how much time it is taking? 3 milliseconds. So completely P1 waiting time is 6, because P2 has to complete, P3 has to complete, then only CPU, P1 will get a CPU. So how much time the waiting time for P1? 6. What is the time taken for a P2? As soon as it is ready, it is being pushed for the ready queue, because the order here is P2, P3, P1. P2 time is 0. What is the time taken for P3? P3 time is 3 milliseconds. Why 3 milliseconds? After P2, P3 will get the queue. So that's what P3. Take all this, take the average. So then how much is the time taken? Only 3 milliseconds is the average waiting time. So compare with the last one. What was the last average time? Last time, here just we have changed only the order of entering the process into the CPU. Yes? So if you take P1, P2, P3 order, it is taking 17 milliseconds. Average waiting time for all these three is 17. Here, they've just changed the order. Here, the order of entering to the CPU is P2, P3, P1. Because of changing only the order, you can see the average waiting time is only 3 milliseconds. And the turnaround time, so turnaround time is what? Completion. Completion of P3 is when? 30. When it completes 30 milliseconds, then only the P1 will be completed. So P2 is when it will complete 3 milliseconds only. P2 work will be over. P3 work will over when? At 6 milliseconds. So calculate this, divided by 3 is 13. Check with the last time. So last order took 27 milliseconds. And this order is taking only 30 milliseconds. Here the throughput will not change, because the same three processor in the same time. So 0.1. So we can observe here, the time taken in a first come first serve is based, we can observe the average waiting time substantially. If there is much variation in CPU burst time, then definitely the waiting time will increase. So you can just compare with the first same example, but only the change in the order. So in this order, if the order of the processor P1, P2 was entering the queue, then the average waiting time was 17 and the turnaround time was 27. So the order has been changed. So if the processor gets P2, P3 and P1, so then this was the order: P2, P3, P1. So P1 is 6 and average time taken was 3 milliseconds and average turnaround time will be 13 milliseconds. So that's what you can say. Waiting time is reduced and even a turnaround time is also reduced if the order is matched. So the disadvantage of having the first come first service is non-primitive. Non-primitive means until it gets its time, it will not come out. Hence the average waiting time can be more. So that's what you can see in the first order, it was taking 17 for waiting time. Whereas in the second order, you can see only 3. So what is the difference? Only the order, the processor entering the queue. And one more disadvantage of this first come first serve is troublesome in time sharing system, where each user needs to get a share of CPU. But first come first serve scheme will keep CPU for a longer duration. So that's what you can see in the first example. First way of entering the CPU, first P1 only is taking 24 milliseconds. 24 milliseconds, and it is bigger time taken compared to P2 and P3. So definitely P2 and P3 has to wait for a longer time. So this is a disadvantage of this first come first serve. Small jobs can be done fast and sent. Whereas because it is first come first serve, till P1 is complete, P2 and P3 cannot complete their work till P1 is done. So this is one disadvantage of the first come first serve because it is taking CPU long time. So I'll just stop here. So in the next session, we'll start with the shortest job first scheduling. And one more thing I just want to say, So maybe in the next class, I'll be trying to use send you invitation through. We don't want to use a Zoom. We may shift it to a Google Meet. Yes, most of you. I will send you the link through your group mail ID. I'll forward it. You can just go there. Every one of you have your mail ID. Log in with your mail IDs. You can see there how you are doing Drive. So if you want to go for a Google Drive, once you have logged in your Gmail, you can go there. Same way here also, Meet. When I send you a link, you just click on that and go to Meet. We can do the same way how we are doing in a Zoom. Maybe in another, maybe next class or next class, I'll start with the leaving. I want to come out of this Zoom. Then we'll move on to a Google. So I'll stop here, and the time is running out. Because even here in this Zoom also, they're restricting the time, only 40 minutes. Maybe that is not there, the option in your Google. So that's what we tried to do it. At least before you come to the next class, at least see how to log in with the Meet, M-E-E-T, in a Google. What you have to do is log in with your Gmail account. It should be open. Then click there how you have Drive. When you click on a Drive, you have so many options there, right? There, click on a Meet. That's the option where we'll see. I want to go shift to a Google because Zoom is having some disadvantages like time limit. So to do this next class, I hope everyone should at least, because Wednesday is my next class. So Wednesday, fourth hour is what time? 11:50. Yes. So we'll meet next class on 11 Wednesday, right? So next class is on Wednesday. So what time, if I say fourth hour is Wednesday's class, 11:50. So I don't send the message every time. So I'll follow the timetable as it is. But only thing, because the sir wants on Thursday, sir requested me to take 8:30. So only Thursday, I don't know. Because last 2 days I was taking, last 2 weeks, Thursdays 8:30 I'll be taking. Only that, leaving that, as usual, I'll be taking my classes on the according to the timetable. Okay. So any problem, anything you're facing? How about others? Most of your friends are not coming to the Zoom, to the online classes. What's your problem?
Network.
Okay. So, however, we are even sending this to your, it is available. This video is available even in our YouTube. You can just, your friends can ask. Because every class I'm just maintaining only, not more than 20 people are coming. Less than 20 only we are able.